It's time to get sexy on Secular Sexuality.
Hello and welcome to Secular Sexuality, the ACA show that was offered a gender at birth and decided to politely decline. Joining me, of course, is your favorite short hair, Vila Bianca.
Hello, everybody.
And here today with us in the studio is trans therapist and educator, Billie Beard.
Hi.
Billie has put together for us a couple of names missing from your history books, so we'll be speaking to her today about some of those trans icons, as well as the broader question of why America's kind of just now learning their names. So for those questions or any others, please jump on the lines and join us at 512-686-0279. That again is 512-686-0279.
Awesome. And before we get started, I do want to give just a kind of quick announcement. The ACA right now, due to the outbreak of coronavirus in the U.S., is only accessible to essential personnel. We just want to make sure that if you were planning on coming down one of these days to attend a live show, that you postpone that for a few weeks while we get everything sorted out. Every show is still going to be coming to you live. We're still going to be recording. Everybody who needs to be here is still going to be here. But if you've been planning to come down, maybe postpone that for a couple of weeks. Also, unfortunately, the American Atheist Convention in Phoenix is postponed for a year. Next year will still be in Phoenix at this time. And everyone who has bought tickets for that event, everything should roll over into next year, according to Nick Fish's most recent announcement. So just a couple of updates in case you've been following and wondering what's going on in the atheist community with this whole pandemic situation. Yeah. But let's not bring the night down by talking about that. Let's talk about gender.
Yeah, okay, so we'll just go ahead and pivot to something much more simple and less fraught with anxiety.
Right, okay. Yeah.
Well, Billie, you wanted to spend tonight sort of highlighting the life and times of trans folks who lived in, you know, various versions of this young country. Mm-hmm. Why is it important to acknowledge these everyday stories?
Let's see here. I think a lot of us want to see people like us reflected back. I know when early in my transition, it was just like, I don't know anybody that's trans. I don't have any history. I feel like I'm alone. So that's how I kind of got started with looking and finding people just throughout history. It was like, okay, I just need somebody to kind of look as like a role model. They had challenges, but able to have a successful life. I wanted to actually see like, okay, instead of just what I was exposed to as a kid, which was Jerry Springer and daytime TV.
Right, so. Right. Or that idea of a trans person as like a psychopathic killer.
Exactly.
Or, you know, a closeted gay man or some.
Yeah, a lot of times are where the story always ends like, oh, and then they die.
Yeah.
Yep.
I would really like that to not be the, I'm kind of over those stories.
The whole sure. Barrier days trope.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, when we're looking at these historical documents and kind of combing through for, you know, people who have been sort of obscured or otherwise just aren't at the forefront, I feel like a lot of people would say that we're rewriting history by looking at these things. How would you acknowledge that?
I think it winds up being that we tend to erase. We have a long history of whitewashing things where it's like, okay, well, we always go like, oh, well, these are the founding fathers. These are the people that, these are the men that started Silicon Valley. All these different things where we constantly always focus on men, typically white. So I think it's important for all minority groups to actually be represented true through the history because there's a lot more complexity and a lot more diversity than what we were all taught.
Yeah, so it's really less of like rewriting history and more just kind of like re-editing it to actually include people that weren't just, you know, rich white dudes.
Yeah, I'd say we're rewriting history every time we talk about it, right? Yeah. We're always finding new things about what happened and new ways to describe it and new people to celebrate. So why is it only a problem when there are certain people being highlighted?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Sure, absolutely.
Well, and then I guess the question is, why has it been so important to the victors, the history writers, frankly, the rich white dudes, to, I guess, erase or cover up or just not even notice these stories?
I think it winds up being that, in academia, who's usually in charge? It's typically white cis male. Who's in charge of writing the books? Who's doing the publishing? They want themselves reflected. And I think there's kind of that thing of like, I want to identify with people. So they don't really identify with women. They don't identify with queer people. They don't identify with. So I think at some level, I think it's kind of an unintentional bias. Mm-hmm. A lot of times, then there's also other people which intentionally are going like, I want to make sure that we believe that these people are inferior, therefore I'm going to erase this history.
Yeah, cover up any accomplishment or anything.
Exactly.
Yeah, with that, go ahead and tell us the story of Lynn Conway.
We talked a little bit
about her.
She's quite an interesting woman, and it's only been recently that they've kind of really discussed like what she actually did as far as like within computer tech. So she started working at IBM in around 66 to 68, and her first accomplishment was doing out-of-order execution instructions, which basically allows you to do a whole bunch of different things like, oh, do this for a while, then stop and do this. Which is a pretty big, important part of, like, computers. When she came out as being trans, she was immediately fired. She transitioned and then went to work for Xerox over at Park. If you ever see anything on Apple, it's where Steve Jobs went and stole everything in the story of it. So she goes on ahead. And one of the things that helped her to get her foot in the door was the fact that at this time, most programmers were women because most men felt that using to actually type is a woman's job. Therefore, they were completely turned off about programming. So this is what got her in the door. So it was sexism that gave her the opportunity to actually do this thing.
Fantastic.
So it's kind of weird. So her big, huge accomplishment was VLSI, and that's very large scale integration. So before, what you would have to do is a whole team of people would have to go on ahead and they would have to physically etch the board. And you'd have to do this, so it would take 100 people, multiple engineering staff, months and months of work, so only the biggest companies could actually do this. So basically, she had the brilliant idea of like, hey, I've got this computer, I know the limitations of what the technology is, I just program and let the computer figure out a lot of the other minutiae, and I can do it myself. So she goes on ahead, and she does this. She shows it to Mead. And then he was like, oh, that's great. And then he started up a team to go on ahead and get started on that. And then she walked in on that team and was like, and one of the research assistants said like, hey, look at what Mead did. It's like, and it was all her work.
Oh, God.
So she was basically like, I'm not going to show him anything, and I'm just going to do this by myself. So basically this essentially allowed you to do everything. So basically it winds up being kind of like the printing press. Because before, if a book was being made, it had to be done in like a monastery, and then all these monks would spend months and months writing like the Bible and things like that.
Transcribing it by hand.
Yeah. So basically what she ended up doing was like, oh, I can now make it where one person can do it themselves, and all they have to do is just send it out to be printed, and then you're done. Instead of like months to actually do it, you can now do it in like a few weeks and design this so then it makes microchips much, much cheaper. She wrote the textbook. She went over to MIT, got a class started, then also integrated it where you could basically like, so the first 6-7 weeks, you'd go on ahead, you'd learn how to use the software. The next 7 weeks, you would design your own microchip. And then you could basically email it through the early internet to Xerox, and they would print it for you, and then a couple months later they would mail you the chip you designed.
Wow.
And did it for like by 1981 they were already doing this at like over 100 universities.
Interesting.
So it's just really amazing thing. So it basically trained almost everybody.
I have to just take a quick moment to point out that my sixth grader was complaining about the fact that it took 4 hours for his computer lab to 3D print a tabletop Pikachu, which I didn't even know that you could string all of those words together in that order. But it's fascinating and baffling to put those things next to each other, but also just, I think, highlights sort of the remarkableness of the creation.
Yeah, and what basically ended up happening was, so if you look at trade magazines back in like 81, they were like, oh, it's Conway and Mead, they did this, you know, and like you have it. And then by 89, it's now just Mead. And by 2009, basically he was getting an award in Silicon Valley as one of the founding fathers of Silicon Valley. And Conway didn't get the message. So she just happened to be visiting friends in California. So basically she was like, no. And she basically got all the documentation, compiled it, put it all online, and then basically said like, no, I did a lot of this work. So she finally got her credit. But she, you know, the reason why she didn't fight for so long was because she was stealth for so long. So, I mean, it wasn't until about 99 when she actually started to kind of come out a little bit. So it wasn't really until about 2012 that she really was making herself known throughout the general public.
Well, and just explain briefly, if you would, what stealth means and why somebody would be concerned about, I guess, putting their name on their accomplishments.
So stealth winds up being that for a long time that was what trans people had to do, was if you go on ahead, you transition, you need to never talk about it, never bring it up, never let anybody find out, never tell loved ones or anything, just kind of pretend like it didn't happen.
Basically just tell everybody that you're cis, or let them assume.
Exactly. And then it winds up being, and but then at the same time you're also like, what is a safety thing? And then it wound up being one of those things that it was very much a bit more dangerous back then than it is now. So it's understandable, like, why you would stay closeted for so long.
I mean, the impulse is certainly very human. You know, we talk to folks every week on this show who are calling from places where they don't feel safe. And, you know, that really does come first. It is heartbreaking, however, to think that because of that vulnerability, I guess, that I hate to even call it like a skeleton in the closet, because that implies that it is something to be ashamed of. But because of that vulnerability, that you would, I guess, miss out on taking your rightful place in the world.
Absolutely.
It's also a shame that, because I imagine that part of the reason, and correct me if I'm wrong, part of the reason Lynn didn't want to put her name out there and actually say, no, this is, get embroiled in that confusion and that controversy in the first place, was because people would go digging, and that would be the thing that would come out as something to discredit her, and it would be used against her as a weapon.
And that was also another problem. Honestly, I was absolutely amazed that, so before, like, it wound up being one of those things that they did actually contract a lot of the work out, like DARPA basically pretty much bought a lot of it to actually be able to have it be open source. I was actually kind of amazed that when they did the background check that they didn't find out that she's trans. So I find that kind of amazing that she didn't get discovered back in, 81, 82.
Well, it, to me, I think, kind of highlights just this whole exercise that we're going through and what we're trying to do here, because even in the event that somebody who is trans has the opportunity, has the access, has the chance to get an education, has the positioning to be able to create something miraculous, we often won't hear about it, or won't hear about it in that context, because of that extra vulnerability, because of that safety piece. Yeah, so beyond that, who else did you want to speak with us about tonight?
Let's see here. So when I go a little bit back, it's going to be an indigenous woman, Wei Wa. I'm hoping I'm pronouncing this right, but, you know, since I never heard it from somebody that actually is from the Pueblo tribe, I'm not entirely sure.
I Googled around a little bit myself trying to work that out. I think Wei Wa is the best.
Yeah.
Let's stick with that and just say to the audience that we're open very much to being challenged on that.
Exactly. And she was a La Mana, which is basically kind of a trans woman equivalent within the tribe. So she was a community leader. She was an artist. And basically what ended up coming down in like 1886, basically in order to kind of build a better relationships with the U.S., you know, to kind of prevent all the negative things that were happening to the tribe, like the U.S. government stealing their children to send them for education. Basically, the idea was to kind of show the value of their culture, how, you know, civilized they were, you know, because they always say, like, well, the natives are savages and everything else. So
sure.
The attempt was to basically show that, yes, we have a proud culture. Our culture is valid. We are, you know, just show that, like, yes, we're important. So she goes on ahead. She becomes very popular within D.C. society, becomes friends with the Speaker of the House, meets the president at the time, Grover Cleveland, really does a whole bunch of great work over at the Smithsonian, does all this training and all this great stuff. She, by the end of it, after several months of being there, she goes back home. And then, you know, it's a few years later. It's about 1894-ish. Let me double check. Yeah, 1894. Mm-hmm. Basically, what ended up happening was the U.S. Army decided, well, we're going to arrest the governor of the Pueblo people because a couple of teenage boys from the tribe got drunk and basically caused some stuff, and they were blaming it on the governor, like, oh, you gave them alcohol instead of teenage boys being teenage boys.
Right.
So they attempted to arrest them while it was there, and basically she ended up literally grabbing them and throwing them out. And she was a big woman. She was 6 foot tall, very strong. It's kind of weird going back to the newspaper articles, because it's good that they're using, you know, she, her. It's good that they're talking about, like, you know, not, you know, really criticizing looks, but it's then winds up becoming this kind of exotic fetishizing her, which then is like, well, that's gross.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like, it's
come
like,
come and see the bearded lady.
Yeah. It's kind of one of those things. Like, sure. It's just like this real exotic kind of flavor, like kind of like what a lot of people will do with Asian women.
Sure.
So it's kind of one of those things where it's like, well, that's neat, but that's also really gross, like how they're describing her too. So it's like, okay.
But when you were talking about her being, I guess, very popular in Washington circles, that was mm-hmm. sort of my first question, is like, as a person,
as a sideshow?
Yeah, like I said, I mean, it's one of the things where it's kind of, it kind of goes off on it, where it's just like, I'm not 100% sure. And that's one of the things, like, I'm not sure if it's like, oh, it's something, you know, she's someone different, or is it actually that, I don't know. Like I said, there's just a whole bunch of different things where it just kind of gets kind of muddied and, you know, and you're just trying to go with what the newspapers say at the time. So it's kind of hard to really tell what was going on.
Right.
Well, it, I guess, just serves to point out how inaccurate these data recording devices are.
Exactly.
And how much data is not collected.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still fascinating to know that this story, you know, sort of captured the public's attention, that people mm-hmm. were noticing and being exposed to these ideas as far back as, you know, the 1890s.
Exactly. And there's some interesting history before Jim Crow really came into effect. And there's, you know, and just like there used to be other minorities that used to have positions of power before the turn of into the 20th century, then
right.
a lot of that power was lost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, it's definitely a pretty breathtaking story. Mm-hmm. What do we have? You know, you were talking about a couple of newspaper articles. I mean, how has any of this been saved or recorded?
I mean, that's kind of the thing, is like it winds up being most of the stuff that actually is there is actually from her tribe, is basically where most of the data that I was able to find on it. A few newspaper articles that were written, but it's then hard to be able to get them because not all of them have been digitized to actually be where I can look.
Right.
So there's a whole bunch of different things where it's just I want more, but I can't find more.
Yeah.
So it's kind of frustrating where it's just like I'm really interested in this person, but I'm not 100% sure, like, how am I going to find more information?
I am fascinated by the process of digging up information about somebody who is from the past. I remember I was doing a research project for a musical that I was writing years and years and years ago about Christopher Milne, the son of A.A. Milne, who wrote the Winnie the Pooh books. And somehow it started out with, hey, this guy was a real person. Christopher Robin was real. That's cool. Let's look more about this. To like 2 years later, in the middle of nowhere in the fields of like rural England, in this gigantic windowless building, like with this box of his letters to people. I didn't, I was like, how did I get here? What is happening? It's so much fun. And it's really, there is that really visceral connection to this other person and this keen understanding that I will know them only to a point, and then they just disappear. They turn into mist and Yeah, I'm super curious. How did you? I guess I'm curious about your process. How did you start finding these people? Like, how did you come across this one person who is spoken of in
one or two newspapers? It's one of those things where it winds up being. I have family that live up in Oklahoma, and. Since there is such a large Native population, they have some really great resources on just information on just like different tribes and different things. So I kind of went in there just kind of looking like, can I find anybody on as far as non-binary gender of some kind? And just kind of looking and it's like, ooh, I found something. Let me try to get as much as I can. And unfortunately, like I said, it just kind of stopped. And I'm sure that there are probably people that have been able to find more. And, you know, and I'm, like I said, there's just a whole, and I'm, like I said, this is mostly just I'm an amateur researcher. That's it. So it's not like, you know.
No, I get that it's a passion project.
Yeah,
but I still find it fascinating. And it makes me wonder about, I guess, sort of our future, you know, about when people will be looking back at the counterexamples or whatever from our time. And the reality is there will certainly be more data available. I mean, pending some giant Skynet type apocalypse that, you know, destroys all of our computer systems. You know, I imagine there to be a lot more opportunity, a lot greater chance for people to be seen and for people to at least retroactively be acknowledged. But I also recognize that we already exist in this world that is so flooded with misinformation. It's less about the information that we're losing and more about all of the noise that's kind of overtaking it.
That's always kind of the thing that you don't really know, because there are certain things that get like, oh, well, because there are several different things where I'm like getting like, you know, just trying to find like multiple sources just to say like, okay, this is what happened, or at least as best as I can figure it happened.
Sure.
Because, I mean, there are certain things where it's just like, and then it's also like, okay, I think, you know, some of these newspapers are probably sensationalizing some things. And it's like, well, that doesn't seem right either. That seems a little out there.
Right.
So, like I said, I'm always curious, like, what am I missing? Is there something I'm missing? Because I think it'd be interesting just to be able to find out, but unfortunately.
Well, and I'm such a humanist, sometimes not as skeptically as I perhaps should be. My heart is just so ready to be given over to these ideas about human progress and about the things that we can achieve that I would like to believe that we are, if by nothing else, by simply existing in a day and age where there's better record keeping, creating a foundation for generations ahead of us to have better examples, to be able to listen to podcasts with folks that are non-binary or trans or these different kinds of things. And I'm excited to be a part of that world, but I have to admit there's always a part of me that's nervous, that, you know, looks at what's going on in the news and looks at these different things and can feel very defeated.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's kind of one of those things like things get kind of crazy. I mean, you don't really know, like, you know, there's just certain things that will just occur, and you don't really know exactly what's going to happen, like how are things going to shift. yeah, it's just wild. It's a wild ride.
Yeah, I was talking with a friend yesterday. I was like, I feel so dumb for saying this, but I feel like we're so close, right? Like in 30 years, like when I'm 50 something, like then it'll be fine, right?
Yeah.
Right? That's how that works.
Well, I mean, if nothing else, I have to say that, you know, as a therapist, when I work with teenagers, I'm always really excited and relieved to see that while they are teenagers and they have dumb teenage ideas, as teenagers have for millennia, that they so often know the words. Words that, you know, V, you and I have talked over and over and over again on this show about how much our lives would have been different if somebody had just sat us down with like a modern urban dictionary and give us some vocabulary. And it's exciting for me to see that change.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Definitely. I mean, that's the thing I'm just thinking back is like, you know, I was on the early internet and I was like just finding this stuff, like what little I could find on like my little dial-up modem. I was just like, okay, here we go. The amount of information that's been coming out where I'm just like, okay, this is great. You know, just to get to, I think things would have been a lot different for me if I had access to the information.
Yeah.
I think, you know, that's just kind of one of those things where, you know, but that's what happens is like you don't get all that information. But now at least kids are being able to kind of explore it, or at least just hear about it, where they at least know like, oh, those people exist. It's like, okay, that's cool.
Yeah.
And then they go do whatever.
Yeah, I have to say, I'm a little embarrassed now to remember that, you know, I was using dial-up internet to search bikini.com because it wasn't blocked by my parents' search filter. So
oh, my goodness.
That's a true story that now, I guess, lives on the internet forever. let's continue, I guess, by talking about Charlie Parkhurst.
Okay, now, he's really interesting. After reading about him, I really want there to be a Western about this guy.
Ooh.
Because he's just really interesting and fun. So Charlie was born about 1812, lived in, I think it was Vermont, if I remember correctly. And basically, by the age of 16, he ended up going ahead, started living full-time as a man, and headed west. Spent time as a blacksmith. And worked for the stagecoach. He actually rode shotgun for Wells Fargo with all the gold stagecoaches and went across there. So there's like these stories of like him going on ahead and like bandits trying to raid his stagecoach, and he's like shooting them down by himself because it's just him. He doesn't even have like a driver. He's just like driving and then shooting with a shotgun. It's just kind of awesome and just really cool. And got like, you know, it was like missing an eye after being kicked by a horse in the head. And just and it was just kind of neat. Like there's this story of him coming into town. This woman, you know, lost her husband and had a kid. And, you know, it's like, and basically they're about to lose the house. So he just goes on ahead, goes in there, pays off the mortgage, pays the bank. And then within like a week, he rides off into the sunset, and then he just continues doing what he does. like I said, it's just really cool. I just kind of want this kind of like this badass. And that's where it winds up being like really interesting with the newspapers. Like when he died of cancer of the tongue, and basically he ended up dying. And the newspapers, like the obituaries when it first in the papering, it was like, legendary Wells Fargo stagecoach hand dies, and you know, and like all these really beautiful stories.
Mm-hmm.
And then they find out that, anatomically speaking, Charlie was female. It's like, and then it became the terrible sensationalist stories that you hear, where they're like, you know, it's like, just start calling him like a pervert and all this other shit and all this other stuff. And then they were making up story. There's like stories of like, oh, well, they end up finding these baby clothes in like his house, and it's like, oh, he must have had like a miscarriage, like all these really random stuff.
That's so,
and it was like these real sensationalist stories, and it's just like, okay, from like the friends' statements that were given, like during like the obituaries, basically, it was like, no, he was celibate, and it was like, okay, now does that mean that he was, or was he gay in the West? Possibly, I don't know. But yeah, I don't think that it winds up being, like I said, I really don't know. All I can basically go like the stories about him as a stagecoach driver and, you know, all this other stuff is like, okay, I'll believe that. You know, I'm much more,
right.
It's like, okay, but, you know, was he a gay trans man? Possibly, I don't know. But yeah, it's just these really, I don't know, it's just kind of interesting. The thing that I don't like is the fact that there's a plaque in California saying that Charlie was the first woman to vote in a presidential election in California.
Ooh.
And I don't buy that because, you know, from 16 to 67, he lived as a guy. I'm going to say he's a guy.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Like I said, because it's just like, yeah, they didn't have the word transgender, but I'm 99% sure that he identified as a man.
Everybody knew him as a man.
Yeah, exactly. And everybody treated him as a man. Everybody respect, you know, all this stuff where it's just like, I'm going with how he chose to live his life.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, that's who he was.
Wow.
Yeah.
Damn, I want a trans gay Robin Hood Western.
Yeah,
I know.
I'm not gonna lie. I've been trying to figure out who I would cast.
Oh my God.
Like I said, I want it. I think it would be amazing.
Uh-huh.
And
if we say Timothy Chalamet, will you make it?
No.
Please?
Jeff Nichols needs to direct. Never mind. Yeah.
Like I said, I really just want it, and I think it'd be amazing. Yeah. And yeah. Like
wow.
I said, it's just all I want.
Oh, I love that. I'm okay. Consider my interest fully piqued. That's amazing.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting to kind of ask ourselves this question of, does it even matter, you know, who this person was so much as, you know, now how we remember them,
mm-hmm.
you know, and knowing that this story is sort of weirdly constructed, but coming at this from like a skeptic's point of view with a understanding that Charlie is dead, that soul no longer exists or however we want to conceive of that. But that the important thing is sort of the story that they left behind, and grappling with that very mixed message of, you know, this incredible manly man hero versus this weird pervert, and
mm-hmm.
just how our society's chosen to interpret those experiences,
and the fact mm-hmm. that there are so many less interesting stories that I was taught as a kid.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
As like, oh, these are the names you know because of this marginally interesting thing they may or may not have done.
Yeah.
Versus this person who sounds fucking amazing.
Yeah.
Like, we need, like, Charlie Parkhurst needs to be, like, a fucking, like, household name, Halloween costume. Like, obviously you're Charlie with your one eye, your cowboy hat,
exactly.
your Wells Fargo, whatever. Yeah.
Exactly.
I love it.
There's like a new Paul Bunyan movie like every 10 years. Why? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Exactly.
Okay. Well, moving on, we wanted to read an email that we received.
Yeah. And I'll just jump in and read that out.
Great. Thank you.
It says, I am recently divorced from a woman who was Christian but not practicing. I am now trying to get out there and date again. I've been on a bunch of dating apps and sites and have had about a dozen connections where communication has started, but every single time it comes up that they're Christian and that their faith is the most important thing to them. And when they ask what I believe and I respond I'm an atheist, I never hear from them again. How does an atheist get out there and date again when it seems like everyone is buried in their Christian beliefs and won't give any time to someone who believes differently? This doesn't just affect my attempts at dating life, but also my relationships with my friends and family. I feel very alone, and any advice would help.
Hmm.
So kind of a straightforward one, but also immensely difficult.
Yeah. I am incredibly curious about sort of the context. I mean, how I know that I am incredibly lucky and thrilled, honestly, to be living in a city where you can set your, you know, OkCupid search filters to atheist and it matters, or polyamorous or anything along those lines, and be kind of inundated with a number of different results. I mean, that community can feel very small at times, for sure.
Lots of double dipping happening.
Yeah.
Well, that's the nature of polyamory, is that there's enough double dipping that, you make it around the block quite a few times.
Oh, yeah.
But in any case, I think that has to be kind of the place to start. And I know that's the answer that nobody wants to hear, but move. you know, to an extent. It's opening up your horizons by being in a place that is full of people that are going to line up with who you are and what you're looking for.
Yes, I am curious to know where this person lives. Mm-hmm. That would definitely help that decision.
Yeah.
Another thing, depending on where you live, if it's a very small town, then, yeah, your options are going to be limited. But I'm kind of remembering, I don't know if you watched The Last Talkie then, but there was someone named Raquel, and her kind of issue that she brought to us was that she was leaving her faith. She was no longer, or moving out of that, but she still was very socially conservative.
Sure.
And very much of a certain, you know, persuasion, you know, no sex before marriage, like all of these things. Mm-hmm. And we expressed that, you know, you don't need to be mm-hmm. polyamorous and kinky to be
an
atheist.
A fair point.
You can be somebody who is more conservative. That said, it could be that you're used to a certain circle of people, and so you're going to that circle of people to find people to be with, mm-hmm. and you need to actively look for other groups of people. Mm-hmm. Because maybe analyze your dating profile. What kinds of things are you listing as things you like to do? What kinds of things are you listing as places you like to hang out? These things will attract a certain type of person.
Sure.
So maybe look at how you're presenting yourself on these apps, and see maybe who comes up with you if you tweak a few things.
Yeah. Well, and then I guess just a little bit of app literacy. You know, it's not clear from this email where they're coming from or what app they're using. But, you know, as I mentioned, like OkCupid allows you to filter people by their religion. And a number of apps do offer that. You know, if you are on Tinder, you really don't have a whole lot to go off of. And you can find yourself, you know, 2, 3, 4 days into a conversation, into a proto relationship, that is not at all for you.
It's also a really interesting, it is an interesting concern bringing that up in the first place, because if you're with somebody or you're interested in being with somebody and you have been talking, when do you bring it up? Because if it's not very important to you, but it's very important the other person accept you for who you are, bringing it up right away, you know, you might sound like very aggressive, like the angry atheist, like, well, I'm an atheist.
Yeah.
If you're not, then I don't want to be with you. You know, it doesn't have to sound like that either. Like if you want to broach the subject maybe in a more gentle way, in a way that facilitates communication and conversation rather than this is my line in the sand and this is your line in the sand. Mm-hmm. It can be tricky though.
Yeah, it definitely can be, and I think another piece of this, without, you know, wanting to, like, overly analyze a total stranger, is the possibility that there's some discomfort around these religious beliefs, you know, whether that's because you came out of religion, whether it's because of, you know, the relationship that ended and sort of the trappings of Christianity. If that's something that is really triggering to you, potentially you're being made uncomfortable by things that would otherwise, you know, by people that would otherwise be able to have a great relationship with you. Mm-hmm. And so if that's where you're at, where you are just absolutely refusing to date somebody who has religious belief, which I totally support, I certainly don't require from anybody else. It is me. I'm not interested in dating anybody who has a religious belief. But just because you're atheist doesn't mean you have to date in atheist communities.
Right. That is a very good point. And I think the one line that kind of jumps out to me here is every single time it comes up that they are Christian and that their faith is the most important thing to them, when they ask what I believe, I respond, I am an atheist, and I never hear from them again. The way that conversation sounds like it happens a lot of the time feels very aggressive, just in the way that that's being relayed. And, you know, mm-hmm. I could be completely wrong in misreading this, but there are Christians for whom it's not the most important thing in the world. And as long as you are respectful of their beliefs, if you can tolerate them, and maybe present things not necessarily as I'm an atheist and that's the only way, and more of, well, I'm not religious myself and I don't believe in any higher power, but do you want to go get coffee sometime? We could talk more about this. You know, like if you're willing to do that, that is also an option.
Yeah. I'm just thinking back of growing up in a small town, mm-hmm. and just the super negative thoughts that I, you know, things that I was told about atheists and all these other horrible things.
Oh yeah.
So I'm not sure exactly where they're at. So, but I could understand, like, if they hear the word atheist, they're gonna run just because of the negative connotations.
Right. Exactly. If you are in a small town, seeing the word atheist is kind of.
I mean, it'll clear a bar.
It's a
for
good
sure.
If you want a table by yourself. Like, yeah. it's a great way to do that.
Yeah.
I've got atheist stickers all over my laptop, and there have been times where an entire coffee shop has been crowded except for my table, and I'm just spread out, just like I'm enjoying this a lot.
Yeah.
So, yeah, hopefully that helps a little bit. And thank you for writing in. If you are interested in writing to us and having us analyze you over the internet, you can reach out to the email address sex@atheist-community.org. Or if you're interested in maybe leaving a voicemail, we do play the voicemails on the air and answer them in that way as well. And that is our voicemail box at 512-666-0275. Mm-hmm. 512-666-0-ASK. So yeah, if you're not comfortable calling in or being on the air yourself, you can leave us as many voicemails as you want. Just make sure we know which one you want us to pick at the end.
Okay, well, the last person that we wanted to talk about was Jackie Shane, and I don't feel like we would be doing that conversation justice if we didn't take just a moment to listen to some of Jackie's music.
Yeah.
So if we can, I'd like to cue the folks in the booth and go ahead and play just a clip from Jackie's song, Any Other Way.
Yeah. And you say that you're my friend, but I don't know why you're here. She wants to know how I feel. Tell her that I'm happy. Tell her that I'm gay. Tell her I will. Any other way.
Love that brass.
Oh,
right,
I like it.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, and the echo is back.
yep.
Okay, so yeah, we've got, a little bit of context.
Yeah, totally.
Hit us. Tell us Jackie's story.
Okay, so she was born in 1940, Nashville. Mm. So she kind of had a whole bunch of things going against her growing up.
I mean, she was born in 1940 Nashville.
Yeah, she was born in 1940 Nashville. She is, well, was black. You know, being black, seen as gay, Nashville, 1940. Not exactly a great time. When she was in her 20s, she ended up moving up to Toronto. Like a lot of black artists, you got to leave the U.S. to get anywhere. Mm-hmm. And I think at first she did kind of identify as like gay, and then was kind of doing seen as like, you know, drag performance almost. But then eventually, you know, it kind of shifted over to like, no, I'm really, this is who I am as a person. Mm. And one of the things I thought was really interesting, because I didn't find out about her until 2017, mm-hmm. When basically this music historian basically ended up knowing about her, found her, like basically tracked her, just kind of like saying like, what happened to this woman? And basically ended up finding her in Nashville in her mid-70s.
Wow.
And was like, you know, which honestly being a black trans woman alive, making it to their 70s when they they transitioned back in the mid-60s is just amazing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Especially since right now the life expectancy of a black trans woman is 35. The life expectancy of if you are a woman in Afghanistan is 49. So just a little context.
Wow.
That the U.S. for trans
Yay,
women of color
America.
Is more dangerous than Afghanistan. She ended up actually with that track, she ended up getting her first hit. It was like in Toronto in 1962. And then a couple years later, in 65, it got reissued and actually became a national hit within Canada, which did actually lead to her coming back down to Nashville, where she ended up doing a late show down in Nashville called Night Train that focused on blues and R&B artists. Actually, the clip for that performance is also queued up, where it basically can actually show part of it. I'm once again surprised that the video footage survived and they were actually able to transfer it over to YouTube. So that was rather impressive that it did survive, because a lot of those tapings were just thrown away.
Yeah.
I'd love to take a look at that.
Mary Mac, dressed in black. Silver buttons, old Donald back. Hollow, gypsy toes. She broke a needle, says she can't sew. Walking the dog. Just a walking the dog. If you don't know how to do it, we'll show you how to walk the dog. Ask a mother for 15 cents. See her elevator and jump. Just the sky. Never got back till the 4th of July. Just a walk in the dark. If you don't know how to do it, show you how to walk the dark. Mary May, like a tray. Tell me, baby, how does your God grow? You got silver bells, copper shells. If you don't know how to, I'll show you how to walk the dog.
Delighted to see the footage so well preserved.
Yeah, I was really surprised when I found and seeing that on YouTube. It was like, holy shit, it still exists.
My gosh. That's so cool.
Yeah, and one of the other things I'm reading about is that, like I said, she was right on like that cusp of being able to kind of break out in the U.S. Mm-hmm. And she was offered to play Ed Sullivan back, you know, because that was the big deal.
Yeah.
But basically she ended up saying no because Ed Sullivan was like, you have to perform as a man. It's like, it's just as a man. It's like, nope, not going to do it.
That?
So exactly. Wow. So it's like, nope, we're not going to do that. And basically it was just one of those things that I think there's something to be said about actually being able to have the integrity to basically say no when it's basically like, this could completely build your career.
Right.
I mean, that's it's one thing, that's really hard to maintain your principles whenever it comes to that. And it's just like, I think that alone is just impressive, just to be able to say no.
Yeah, I find that pretty remarkable. And it kind of, I guess, answers a question that I had in the back of my mind, which was, is all of this happening sort of in private? You know, the way we talked about Charlie Parkhurst just living his life as a man very publicly and being perceived as that, versus this other story of, I guess, people being sort of in on it,
everybody
being
knew.
Out as trans. Yeah.
And it was kind of one of those weird things where it's just like, so, you know, back then, you know, anything is like, you know, everybody kind of knew like that she was, you know, queer or gay or whatever they were using as terminology, but
however they chose to frame it.
Yeah, however they chose to frame it. It was just one of those things like everybody knew. It wasn't like, it's like, okay. And then it's just this really weird thing because, like, I do know of other musicians around that time that, are trans, that were, you know, trans at that time, but they were stealth, so nobody knew until after they end up dying. Mm-hmm. So I just found that really interesting. It's like, okay, no, she was actually out in 1962.
Wow.
And performing on television.
And performing on television in 1965.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So it just was surprising.
Also, if you're interested to hear who these other musicians of the time were, you'll have to tune in next time we have Billie on the show.
Exactly. I got a couple of new ones. So yeah, we can do that. I wouldn't mind doing a whole episode on just trans musicians.
Oh my goodness. Yeah. Neither would I, especially if we get amazing clips like this where I'm going to go home and listen to these. These sound really fun and all.
Yeah, they did do a re-release of all of her recordings. It's a double LP or a double CD. They do have that available too that you can order.
In case you have a CD player.
I still have an 8-track. It's okay.
Oh, wow.
Nice.
Okay. That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
ASMR moment there.
Yeah, exactly.
8-track.
Well, we've been kind of filling in some of these gaps in American history. Mm-hmm. But I want to point out that you kind of threw me a little bone of information that I couldn't help but sort of latch on to.
Right.
Describing what some of the gaps in ancient, I guess, Judeo-Christian history might look like. And I recognize that you are not here as a historian or anything else.
Exactly.
I did want to take a second to just sort of scratch the surface on that and see, you know, maybe what we don't know or maybe what is missing from the histories that we do have.
Yeah, there's some really interesting stuff that you get into when you look at Jewish teachings where they in Tabitha, they do talk about there being 6 genders. Mm-hmm. And this, at least as far as recording, depending on which gender it is, dates between the first and 6th century CE. So it kind of winds up being this really interesting thing where, it's kind of odd because there's different interpretations of what they're actually trying to say.
Sure.
And since I am not a Jewish scholar, I do not want to, some interpret it like, oh yeah, so some of these are like, they do describe intersex conditions, but then there's also like, oh, well, this could also be like, it could be seen as intersex, but it could also be seen as what would be a trans woman or what would be a trans man. So it's this really interesting, it's kind of shaped, it's kind of clouded, like you don't really know. It kind of got lost through history just because of the fact that it's like, okay, it's written in this one source, but then how do they actually use it in practice?
Right.
That's kind of been lost. I'm just kind of at the surface. I'm trying to remember. There was a book that actually was. It's a. I can't remember the trans man's name, but anyway, he basically kind of dives into, the history of non-binary genders through Jewish culture, which I think was interesting. I just haven't had the time to sit down and read it.
Sure.
So I don't want to say like, oh, this is absolutely this or this is absolutely that.
Yeah, for me, the thing that makes it interesting is that we're not talking exclusively throughout all of human history before, now.
Exactly.
Describing something that was entirely or exclusively marginalized. Mm-hmm. To recognize that trans folks have, of course, existed, anciently and mm-hmm. forever, but not only existed, but have on occasion been in cultures and societies that perhaps accepted them or at least were willing to write about them and acknowledge their existence as something other than a random perversion.
Exactly. So, that winds up being the interesting thing. I think one of the main reasons why society-wise we kind of dumped the idea of more than 2 genders is the ancient Greeks, they did, I'm not knocking everything the Greeks did. Geometry is fantastic. but their science is a bit lacking. And it wouldn't have been so bad if it basically, the Romans adopted it, and then they conquered most of Europe, and then Europe colonized most of the world. So we're kind of stuck with this ancient idea that was bad when it came out, and we're just kind of stuck with it, and we're trying to get rid of it, and we're trying to go back to the beauty of kind of these gender, all these different types of genders that were accepted worldwide for, thousands of years, where, we're digging up grave sites with people that, like, the skeleton is like, okay, well, this is a male skeleton, but it's like they buried them in the traditional way that you'd bury a woman. So it's like it definitely appears like, oh, okay, well, this was some kind of trans woman type gender expression within this culture, and the way that that they were buried showed signs of respect, that they were a valued member of the community. You know, and same thing with female-bodied individuals. They were buried as warriors, you know, kind of like fathers, things like that, where these keep on coming up. It's like, okay, this isn't just some new thing that them crazy queers are coming up with. This has kind of been, you know, that's always been kind of here.
It's always interesting to me too that the way to discredit it is to call it new.
Yeah, that is like, such a common argument.
By default, new has no bearing on
exactly
how valid or true a thing is.
Exactly.
So even like not to put aside anything that was just said, because oh my goodness, I now want to go back and reread all of the books about about this. But the concept of like, oh well, it's new, so it's bad.
Yeah.
Is such a telling mindset to me.
Yeah, I'm also disturbed by the fact that people are like, well, it's a choice, therefore it's wrong. It's like, but a lot of things are a choice. Your religion is a choice.
Right?
I mean,
no, that's a whole other topic we can go on forever
about. Exactly.
The idea that we have to, like, it's not a choice because I wouldn't choose. It's like, actually, I would. I kind of like that. So, like, the having to back into a corner saying it's not a choice, I was forced into this almost, just is by itself problematic.
Yeah, I mean, having to create messaging to combat an ignorant point of view that is not inaccurate, but isn't necessarily the best or most genuine version of the argument.
Well, again, it becomes very black and white, very binary, very this or that, when more than likely it's a combination of a lot of different factors that can't be classified as one thing or another, like gender.
With that, I guess it's time to just thank everybody for coming and joining us tonight. I want to make sure to take a moment and acknowledge that a lot of folks are pretty unclear on what's going on in the world right now. And so, yes, we are shutting down the library for a time, but we are still up and running, not just, of course, on YouTube and things along those lines, but if you're finding yourself stuck at home, having to telecommute, feeling maybe disconnected from your world a little bit, our community is still sort of up and thriving on Facebook and particularly in Discord and these other places. And we, of course, would love if you took this extra opportunity to reach out and to sort of join this worldwide digital atheist community of Austin.
Yeah, if you find yourself needing to socially distance yourself from people or self-quarantine or whatever the term is that most applies to you, we're here for you. That's the beauty of being connected on the internet. So yeah, definitely reach out. We've got our Twitter, that's @secularsex. We've got the Discord, we've got our email, we've got that mailbox for you, and we're here every Thursday.
Yeah, and I want to make sure to point out to our podcast audience, of course, that some of the audio that we've been listening to, as well as all the people we've been speaking about, we've got pictures and video clips and all kinds of great things. If you want to check those out, they're going to be in the show notes wherever you're getting this episode. And then to say that you can check that entire video of Walking the Dog by Jackie Shane, and it's really worthwhile to give it a watch. So I hope that everybody will check out those resources. And until then, that they'll go and give themselves a big old orgasm. Or, better yet, give somebody else one. That's our wonderful crew. Thank you all. Have a great day.
What are we doing, man? What are we doing?
No, you're done.